Good evening. We continue our theme on prayer during these midweek Lenten services. And again, we have a little exercise to do later in the service. And I'd like you to turn to the, I think it's the fourth page, the prayer of waiting. And I wanted to sort of let you know that this is going to be coming so that you can kind of prepare yourself. This is an opportunity for the congregation to kneel in prayer or sit and take in this prayer of waiting. And what it's about is, I think in all of our lives, at least at one time or another, maybe even now, you're dealing with an issue in your prayer life with your Lord. Something that you've been praying for some time. It has not quickly resolved, whatever it is that you're praying. And you won't have to speak that out at all. Where it shows, you know how long I have been praying about, and that's something you silently say to yourself. But this gives you an opportunity to deal with that issue, that not all prayers are answered quickly and just exactly the way we want, but we wrestle with dealing with that in our prayer life. So we want to bring that opportunity for you to grow in that area. We begin our worship with the opening hymn. Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain.
Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchmen stand guard in vain.
In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are the sons in one's youth.
Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their enemies at the gate.
Please be seated. I don't think the sound is on. Thank you. The scripture lesson for our meditation this evening is from Luke 23. And as they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. And there followed him a great multitude of the people and of women who were mourning and lamenting for him. But turning to them, Jesus said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. Please join me in prayer. Dearest Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you that we have been able to come here to hear your word, to grow in prayer, to learn the attitude of prayer as well. Bless the preaching of the word and the hearing of it, so that your will might be done in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. How do you pray? Well, I suppose like most people, we probably start out with "Dear God" or something to that effect. And of course, we almost always end every prayer with "Amen," which means yes, we are in agreement with what we have just prayed. But the question this evening is, what falls in between "Dear God" and "Amen"? What do we say? How do we say it? And why do we say it? Now, we have heard in past Wednesdays how God tenderly invites us, like children, to come to their dear Father with their needs. We've also heard that God assures us that there's nothing too big or too small to bring to him, and that he does want to hear our needs. And so in many of our prayers, we live up well to that expectation. We bring our wants to God. Maybe to the point, almost exclusively, that our prayers are "give me" prayers. That is, here's our list of things we need. Now, that's okay to a certain point, I guess. God doesn't want to discourage us from that. But I think he also wants us to realize that we can develop a broader conversation with our Heavenly Father than just those things that we need. That between the opening and closing of our prayer, we can do many other things that are needful for our own spiritual growth and are pleasing to God, to broaden our conversation with God. So this evening, I want to point out to you a handy acrostic that I use to remind myself that my prayer shouldn't just be, "This is what I need, this is what I want," and so forth. And it's handy because it takes the word "pray" to help us kind of go down and mentally check off the things that we want to pray for. P for praise. R for repent. A for asking, yes, and Y for yield. P for praise. God is certainly worthy of our praise. I don't think there's any dispute on that. And we can praise God because He is God. Think of all that He has done. He has given you life. He preserves and protects your life. He gives you the things that you need. These are all blessings. And God is worthy of our praise for those physical blessings and spiritual blessings and all the things that He has given to us. And we do it with joy. Psalm 47, verse 1 tells us, "Clap your hands, O peoples, shout to God with loud songs of joy." So the Psalms, which is sort of the Old Testament hymnal, if you've ever taken a Bible and you've kind of opened it right dead center, you almost always fall in the Psalms, 150 of them. And many of them with praise for what God has done. That is good and worthy for us to do. Thou art through Him, Jesus, therefore let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess His name. So in your prayer life, you can remember to praise God for the gifts He has given you. R for repent. None of us who are descendants of our first parents can claim we have no sin. Indeed, in 1 John, we are told, and we open almost all our services this way, that we are saying that we have sin. If we deny the sin, we make ourselves to be liars. So in our prayers, we should often ask God's forgiveness. I know we do that Sunday at church. Together as a group, we say those words. We join together to confess our sins and ask for forgiveness. But you would be a rare person that didn't sin that much, and you could all sweep it together for a Sunday. So I think all of us could use asking God for forgiveness. Forgiveness that we need each and every day. We know the wages of sin is death. It's very clear. But we also know of God's great grace. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. God indeed wants to forgive our sins, is eager to do that. That's why He sent His Son, Jesus Christ. And also to empower our repentance. Repentance simply means making a 180-degree turn in your life. Once you were going west, but now you're going east, or the other way around. But it is a turnaround. That's what repentance is telling us to do and is leading us. And empowered by the Holy Spirit, He leads us to do that. So P for praise, R for repent, A for ask. Yes, again, I don't want to discourage anybody. I don't want anybody to say, oh, no, Pastor Stump says that we shouldn't be asking too much from God. That's not it at all. Ask what you need. And I'm sure you have a lot of needs. But also ask not just for yourself. I know you don't. You also ask for the needs of your family, your friends, mother or father, if they're still alive, children, yes. But also for those where you're having some trouble. Ask for the power to forgive. Ask the power to be able to share with them good news, to try to bring forgiveness in their life as well as yours. This year, 2021, is a little bit off the regular pattern that was established way back in the 17th century. In the year 1634, the Black Plague was sweeping through Europe. Now, we think we have a problem with COVID, and it is a problem. But in comparison, it's really the sniffles. The Black Plague decimated Europe. 2/3 of the people in Europe died from it. And it was a horrible death. The little German town of Oberammergau was one of those villages that had to face the threat of the Black Death. When it came into their village, over half the people quickly died. Black Death was very fast. And the people cried out to God for help. And he did. Right after they had gathered together in the little village church and cried before God to help them, the last person had died. Now, this was a devastating death. I said half the village died. Only two married couples had remained alive, a lot of widows and widowers. The village was so thankful for what had taken place that they had vowed that every 10 years their village would put on a passion play. They would tell the story of Jesus' death and resurrection. Starting the year 1634, they've done it every 10 years. Now, a few things have bumped the schedule a little bit. COVID did that last year. They didn't have it in 2020. But this was their way, and their descendants, and many generations afterwards, to give thanks to God for all that he has given them. This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. That's the story that they wanted to tell. Ask God, and he will hear you. And finally, why for yield? Now, Jesus teaches that in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy will be done." That's a hard thing to pray for. We are much more interested in telling God how to answer our prayers the way we want them answered. We maybe even be so bold as to give the time and the place where he may answer that prayer. But we should say, as Jesus taught us, "Thy will be done." One of the things that my dad taught me, still as a young child, and you might find this a little bit amusing, he told me, "Eric, when you have a checking account," and I barely knew what that was, "you make sure that if you ever give somebody a blank check, you trust them implicitly." You all know what a blank check is, don't you? Okay. That's not something you regularly do. One time, Linda and I decided that we were going to go to downtown Chicago. At the time, we were living in Cicero, and I just balked at the idea of paying the grievous price of parking my car downtown, $5. Oh, that was just ridiculous. So we would take the Douglas Park L, and we would always go right after rush hour, about 9:30, so that the L wasn't packed. And we happened to be standing in one of the cars. No one else was in the car, just us. And I think it was Linda who spotted something peculiar on the floor. I walked over and picked it up. It was a yellow piece of paper. I flipped it over because it was on its back. It was a check. The company's name was right where it should be, but there was no date. There was no paid to the order of. There was no amount, but there was a signature. Now that's a blank check. Now I would clearly be lying if I didn't have the thought pass through my mind. We could have quite a time. But I knew that somebody was really desperate for this piece of paper. So when we finally got downtown, I called the company up. And I said, "Are you missing anything?" And the secretary says, "You have it?" I said, "Yes, your blank check." "What happened?" "Oh, we gave this to one of our employees and he was supposed to go pay a bill and he came back and he said, 'I've lost it, I don't know where it's at.' He's in a dither, the boss is in a dither, we're all in a dither." And I said, "Okay, well, I've got it. What do you want me to do with it?" Now, I thought they would just say, "Tear it up." Instead, they said, believe it or not, instead they said, "Oh, would you put it in an envelope and mail it to us?" Now, I think it's Ruth who said, "I would never entrust an absentee ballot to the U.S. mail." Did you say that?
Yeah. I believe that.
Yeah. I have a good memory for that. And I know Carol here is just enjoying this story because this is about banking. And I said, "You've got to be kidding." And the person said, "Well, no." And I said, "I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take a scissor and I'm going to cut it from one corner to the next. I will mail you the check number, which is in the upper right-hand corner, and part of the signature and your full name of your company, and I will destroy the rest. This way you know that the check is destroyed and it is the check that you lost." And she said, "Oh, well, okay, if that's what you want to do." I was thinking to myself, you know, I don't have a business degree, but I think I'm a little bit ahead of these people. Yes, you only trust somebody implicitly if you're going to give them a blank check. Well, that's what we do in the Lord's Prayer. We're giving God a blank check. We trust God so implicitly that in our prayers, we trust that God will do the best for us, and maybe even better than what we were hoping to do, even better than we hoped he would answer us. But we trust that God's will be done. I hope we can broaden our conversation and our prayers with God as we think about praising him, repenting our sins and looking to him for forgiveness, certainly asking for the things that we need, but also yielding to God's will, believing, trusting that his will is even better than we can imagine. In Jesus' name, amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with the prayer, or the hymn. Thank you. Please rise. The greatest work project in ancient history ended in disaster. Unexcelled organization and enormous energy concentrated in erecting the Tower of Babel, and what is there to show for it?
Shattered community, garbled communication. The world hasn't recovered from it yet.
And so it has always been when people, abandoning God's way of doing things and forsaking his divine purposes, try to solve their own problems and establish their own worth.
Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain.
Vain labor. The morning they led him away to be crucified between the criminals at the place of the skull, vain to imagine they could evict the Creator from his creation, could snuff out the light of the world, could silence his voice that still thrusts holes through our dead orthodoxy and sham spirituality, could erect that life before whom all who live for themselves squirm.
Vain indeed, they work like the devil and share the devil's defeat.
For God is working still, even at the cross, especially at the cross. His plan and purpose continue forward, even when appearances would argue they have taken giant steps backwards. It goes forth effortlessly when by prayer the Son places the plotters and murderers and their deeds back into the Father's good hands.
Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.
Like a good husband and wife who participate with God in the miracle of making marvelous creatures who walk and talk, so Jesus places the event of his crucifixion back into his Father's hand with a word. He snatches his life and the world from Satan and returns them to him whose business is to accomplish what really counts.
Father, forgive us when we try to get the good life by our own two hands, as if we could arrange the universe by our own efforts.
Yes, Father, forgive us. Left to ourselves, we would not, in our busyness, learn a name, or start a friendship, or follow up on a smile, and certainly not forgive a wrong. Not unless doing so would profit our job or career or profession or position.
Teach us to be like Jesus. Teach us in whatever situation we find ourselves to respond to you and to invest in people.
Whoever does what my Father in heaven wants him to do is my brother, my sister, and my mother.
Father, teach us to forgive.
Please be seated for the hymn. Thank you. Please rise. O Lord God, we give thanks that you are ever at work in our world. Hear our prayers for those who plow the earth and tend machinery, for those who sail deep waters and venture into space. For those who work in offices, warehouses, or labor in stores or factories, for those who work in mines or buy and sell. For those who entertain us, broadcast, or publish, for those who keep homes and train children.
Work through them, O God.
For all who live by strength of arm, skill of hand, for all who employ or govern people. For all who excite our minds with art, science, and learning. For all who instruct, write, teach, or serve the public good.
Teach them to invest in people.
For all who labor without hope or without interest. For those with too little leisure and those with too much. For those who are underpaid and those who pay small wages, for those who cannot work and those who look for work in vain, for those who trade on the trouble of others, for profiteers, extortionists, and greedy people.
Sustain, uphold, guide, and forgive them.
Dear Father, we want honest words on our lips. No thought of ours is hidden from you anyway. We are puzzled about your timing. You know how long we have been praying about. I have tried to be patient about the answer, but Lord, why does your providence have to move so slowly? I know that the seasons come and go in majestic sequence. No prayers of mine could change this. I know that your ways are not my ways, your timing is not my timing. But Lord, how do I, so earthbound, come to terms with the pace of eternity? I want to be teachable, Lord. Is there something you want to show me? Some block you want removed? Some change you want in me or my attitude before you can answer my prayer? Are you telling me to set more emphasis upon some relationship and less upon my want or need? Give me the gift of eyes that see, ears that hear what you are saying to me. Lord Jesus, because you show me on the cross how to pray, putting matters back into the Father's hands, then waiting, come into my heart as I quietly abide in you and let your life flow into me. What freedom it is to know that the Father does not see my threadbare patience or insufficient trust, rather only your patience, Lord, and your confidence that the Father will fully accomplish his plans for the world. In your faith, I thank you for the more glorious answer to my prayer than I can imagine.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated for the closing hymn.
there is.